India is the only country in the world that has an ocean named after it. And it's not for nothing. Because from the beginning of time, Indians have had a great history of maritime exploration, maritime trade, of military excursions over the seas. And so it is only suitable that we should go back and begin to explore this incredible history. So I'm going to give you a very short sort of history lesson. It's thousands of years of history, but I'm going to say it very, very quickly. So if you went back to the Harappan cities, very often we talk about Mohenjo-daro and Harappa, but these are landlocked cities. In fact, one of the biggest sites of the Harappan civilization actually is Dholavira, which today, if you look in a map, looks like it is landlocked, but in fact, was one of the biggest ports, perhaps the biggest port in the world, 5,000 years ago. It's today locked in the middle of the Run of Kutch, because the Run of Kutch is now salt flats, but 5,000 years ago, it was the estuary of two great rivers, the Saraswati and the Indus. And sailors from there would sail down the Konkan coast, as well as sail all the way through to Mesopotamia, to Bahrain, to Oman. Unfortunately, this particular period of naval expansion came to an abrupt end. Due to climate change, the sea levels dropped. The Saraswati dried up, and these cities were abandoned. But that didn't mean that we abandoned our maritime explorations. The history of maritime exploration then shifts to the east coast, to the area that we now know as Odisha and West Bengal. So the coast between the Hooghly outlet of the Ganga and Lake Chilika then became, in the Iron Age, a major source of maritime activity. And you see ships sailing down from Odisha, Bengal area, down the coast to Sri Lanka, but also sailing the other way, along the coast. And remember, at this juncture, this is 5th, 6th century BC, they didn't know how to cross the oceans directly, so they had to hug along the coast, and they would go along to the Isthmus of Kra, which is the bit of Thailand from which Malaysia hangs off. And they would cross over to the other side and then sail to the Mekong Delta, which is now Cambodia and Vietnam. And then from there, they would sail all the way to Korea and China and Japan. And in fact, Korean history, as it is taught in their textbooks, actually begins with the marriage of a local prince to a princess from Ayodhya. So how did the princess from Ayodhya get to Korea? Well, by sailing across these sea lanes. Now, by the 1st century AD, Indian mariners had worked out that you could use the monsoon winds to cross the oceans directly. Now, remember that the monsoons are very unique kind of climatic phenomena, in that the winds blow in one direction for part of the year and in the exact opposite direction for the rest of the year. So it allows you to go somewhere and then use the same winds to come back. And so using these winds, merchants from the west coast of India sailed to Persia. They sailed across to Socotra, by the way, which derived from an Indian name, Dweepa Sugadhara. And they would sail through Yemen up to Egypt and the Gulf of Aqaba, which is now Jordan and Israel. And they would then sail, they would then cross the deserts on camel trains and go on to the Mediterranean. So there were lots of Indian merchants in the Mediterranean during the Roman Empire. And similarly, there were Romans and Greeks, etc., sailing to India. And on the other coast, there were Indians from, by this time, the entire coast was full of maritime activity. There were great empires like the Pallavas and the Cholas who built maritime empires. And they were sailing on a regular basis. Hundreds of ships were sailing across from India to Indonesia, to Malaysia. There were great empires, which were Hindu-Buddhist empires called the Majapahit and the Srivijaya. And this was also a period, 1,000 years ago, when there was a lot of geopolitics happening. So very often people think that maritime geopolitics of the Indian Ocean is something modern, but it's nothing modern. There were Indian ships sailing all over the Indian Ocean. So what were the kinds of ships they were using for this? So the kinds of ships they were using was quite a unique design. These were called stitch ships. So how were they different from other ships? Well, the ships in the Mediterranean and also the ships, for example, in the South China Sea, they were built basically by using nails to nail together a ship on a wooden frame. But the Indians came up with a very unique design of tying together a ship, almost stitching it together without using nails. Now, there's a lot of controversy about why Indians did not use nails. There are all kinds of talk about superstitions of various kinds. But let me say, it wasn't because Indians didn't know how to make rust-free nails. In fact, we were the first in the world to find how to do rust-free metal, rust-free iron nails and other metallurgy. Because even today in Mehrauli, you have the rust-free, it's a Gupta era, 4th century AD pillar, which are still not rusted. So we knew how to do rust-free metal. But for reasons that are still debated, we insisted on building our ship using this very unique technology of tying the ship together using the planks. And we have many, many foreigners who left us reports of this. We have Indian texts that mention it. We also have depictions of Indian ships made using this particular technology. And these were not small ships. These were large ships, and we know that they had cabins, they had, and they were, of course, crossing the seas all the time. And this technology basically was used till the Europeans arrived in the Indian Ocean. However, this technology had one big flaw. And so once the Europeans came in the 16th century and began to colonize the Indian Ocean, the Indian technology came up with one major flaw, in that it was not suitable for the use of cannons. And it was not just when the cannons were fired at your ship, but in fact, the ships themselves couldn't take their back blast of their own cannons. So ultimately, what happened is that over time, Indians ourselves, for example, by the Maratha period, shifted on to using the European nailed frame type of ships. And this particular style of stitch ships began to be used for smaller and smaller ships till the late 20th century. And today, this is now a dying art. And there are very, very few people who know how to make ships by stitching it together. Very small coastal fishing boats are made using this technique. But this technique is now rapidly dying out. Luckily, we have one team led by Babur Shankaranji who still have remembered how this technique is done. So I thought it's a great idea that we should try and record how this is done and build a ship using this. For the first time in many generations, we're going to build a proper large ship using this technique. Now, so that you know that this same technique was used by the Arabs. In fact, the Arab dhows used to be built in India because they don't have wood. So the Arab dhows used to be actually, they're actually Indian built Arab dhows. So Babu Shankaranji actually a few years ago helped the Omani government to build a 16th century, 17th century Arab dhow. But we are going to be more ambitious, and we are going to go back another 1,000 years or more to the 4th century AD. So this is a ship that we are going to recreate from 1600 years ago. There are many inputs we have taken, but the rough idea is derived from a painting of a stitch ship in Ajanta. You can Google this up, so I don't have to tell you. Just type in Ajanta ship and you will see the ship. We have adapted it, of course, because the ship that is there has 3 masts, and we didn't think it was suitable for a ship the size we are building, which will be about 21 meters. So we will build one with 2 masts, but nevertheless, other than some safety equipment and some things we will allow for modern technology, this ship will be built essentially for all practical purposes as close as possible to this ancient ship design. And with that, not only are we going to build it, we are going to attempt to sail this. So it's going to take us about, I think, 18 months to build it, another 6 months to test it, and that's very important. Remember, we have not sailed these kinds of ships for generations. So And we not only, and these ships that were there even a few generations ago were not the same as the ones that we are going to build, because we are looking at a ship from 1600 years ago. So there are many, many things we need to understand which are different from modern sailing ships. For example, the hull will be flexible because we have stitched it together and not nailed it. We will use square sails. Today, if you look at yachts of today, they are all lanteel sails, those triangular sails. So those can sail at an angle to the wind in ways that this square ship, a square sail ship, will not be able to do. But we will have to adjust it around a bit to at least be able to sail at a slight angle at least. And so we'll have to experiment with that. We will not be using a rudder. We will be using two trailing oars, which is how the original ships used to be. But again, we have not used these kinds of trailing oars for hundreds of years. So again, we don't know how this will behave, particularly in a storm, which we are almost certainly going to face at some point. So all of these are complete experiments. So we need to test it. And then the idea is, hopefully, in 25, or if it doesn't work, maybe in 26, in Kartik Purnima, which is in November, when the full moon rises and the winds blow from the north to the south, we will try on to recreate something called the Bali Jatra, which is literally called the voyage to Bali from the Odisha coast to Southeast Asia.